Now we'll start the panel discussions. I'll just have one question for each of the panelists, and then probably we'll put the floor open for discussion, for question and answers from the audience, from the delegates. They are the most important people. My first question would be to Rashi sir. I would ask him a question. There are so many solar parks that are coming up in this country. Is it possible with the new policy framework of the government to engage the CTU for the power evacuation and enforcing PSA tie-up with the states that are not fulfilled their RPA obligation? The new setup, is this possible? Is this feasible?
My dear friend, always possible. We can support all this kind of concerns. Of course, Rewa and other solar parks has extended their payment guarantee, security for the grid connectivity, everything has been ensured. For example, in Tamil Nadu, now we are going for the next level of another 500 megawatt of solar park, which is to be developed by Tangent Co, where all these grid guarantee, payment guarantees are already included. So we can ask the government of India, MNRE, to bring the parks mandatorily to support for the payment mechanism, and the grid security both has to be ensured. Regarding the RPOs, already long back some court verdict has come. Now we are talking about RPO to reach 5 to 8% and all. Definitely, we can insist. Already a circular has gone from MNRE to all the state governments and all the DISCOMs. They have to reach and achieve the target on RPO. Definitely, all these are to be considered seriously. We can work together from the association to achieve all these kind of grievances and whatever is the loopholes and coming. For the next point, one point I support the gentleman on rooftop. Yes, rooftop is facing a lot of challenges. We too know very well we cannot reach 40 gigawatt. Definitely, we will reach almost 25% or 30% of that. We also tried to enter into rooftop, but the confusion, the roofs, whatever they are allocating is a lot of instability is there. Number one, suppose they start from, they talk about 5 megawatt or 10 megawatt and 50 megawatt of rooftop. They allocate few hundred locations where the locations are not having any safety and security. Most of the roofs are facing some other issues like shadow, security and a kind of accessibility. Once you install on the third party roof, what is the guarantee? How we are going to approach and access for that? This kind of issues, as well as for the net metering, all the DISCOMs has been instructed recently by the government of India. They should follow. For example, my Tamil Nadu, Tangent Co is indirectly not supporting rooftops and as well as net metering, because they will be losing their revenue. Yesterday here also, power they sell at industries at 6 rupees to 7 rupees. When we ask, they say 4.5. But the rooftops, indirectly, the DISCOMs are not supporting. This is the real fact. We are going to work on that. Definitely, we'll come out with a solution. Policies are not meant for officials or for the DISCOMs. It is for the country and it is for the solar concept. So they have to agree. We'll see that all these things are possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Nasiman sir. I would now one question for both from the gentleman, Mr. Sachin Jain, and also to Mr. Mishra. There has been a lot of concern about the rooftops and what is happening in the space. There is a government target is 40 gigawatt. How are we going to achieve it? But I think the 100 gigawatt can be achieved without the 40 gigawatt happening. Now, in certain countries, look, making complete net metering, filing and approval process completely IT enabled with no interface with DISCOM. Is it possible to do this? That is, sitting in your house or sitting in your office, you should be able to get all your permissions for doing a net metering work. It may be small capacities, but it multiply into big thing. Purely IT enable the whole thing so that you can sit in your office and get your clearances. Is it possible? Is the government working towards this? And what sort of IT infrastructure is required? I would request Sachinji and Mishraji to give their comments on this.
At a first prima facie, that looks very difficult. You know, to have a net metering process itself is very lengthy. What I will say, think of, you know, in rooftop to reach the level of 40 gigawatt, right now there is a lot of funds and capital which are coming in to support rooftop projects. However, the banks, or they are not really aware, you know, like how to really fund these projects. There is no kind of a proper rating mechanisms, right? So a lot of large rooftops where the companies have E rated or plus, it's much easier where you can do a OPEX kind of funding. But a lot of smaller rooftops, which is like 50 kilowatt, 100 kilowatt, so there needs to be a proper rating mechanisms where a lot of large institution money, whether it is World Bank or EDB, where a lot of such capital can be deployed to, you know, in terms of usage. So there could be a very large market which can open up if such ratings are very easily available of each of these industries. So I suggest that is, you know, one of the opinions I will have, you know, to increase the rooftop market.
Thank you, sir. Sir?
So to your point on, you know, IT-enabled net metering process, other than filing paper, I don't see anything really happening. See, it's a very local subject where somebody will have to look at the transfer capacity at the draw point, and it's restricted by that one. Second, the larger benefit would be rather than having an IT-enabled process is to increase the limit on net metering, because we are losing out on a lot of roofs which can be even 4 or 5 megawatts in a lot of the industries where you're limited to a 500 or a 1 megawatt net metering cap. And, you know, at these places, the amount of net metered units would not even be 10% of what you're installing. So the ideal way of utilizing roof is to allow net metering. We'll have whole lot of scale coming up without even getting onto land. And 90-80% of power getting consumed at the same level with hardly 10-20% getting into the grid. For that 10 or 20% plus the revenue loss that DISCOMs would incur, there needs to be a mechanism, whether it's a GBI incentive to the DISCOM, which I think Minister has already coined, and or a gross metering that's happened, either works. But there needs to be one policy which takes care of, you know, the team doing the work and the investors investing, at least for a good 4-5 years. We'll definitely see a company doing 100 megawatt a year. But if none of this happens, scaling even to a 20, 30, 40 megawatts of private rooftop, I'm not even talking of government rooftop, is a challenge, because you end up taking 6 months for a net metering, for example. Karnataka has more than 500 kilowatts go to KERC for getting your PPA approved. That's a pain. You can do 5 megawatts on Toyota, but you can't do more than 500 kilowatts without getting your PPA ratified by the KERC, which is no reason. They don't have to do anything on that, but they'll take 6 months, and obviously it's an expensive process in the whole way around. So it's not about application, it's more about the right framework or the policy, and which stays for at least 3, 4, 5 years.
Thank you. I think the opinion is that it's not possible. Anyway, we should try to make it totally IT enabled. Probably that's the way you can really increase the rooftops. Now I have a question for Bimal Jalanji, Jindalji, I'm sorry for it, from SoftBank. The bullet train project from Bombay to Ahmedabad, it is a 1,10,000 crore project. And we don't know what is the real figure. Probably he'll be able to give us the figure. Is it possible to do it entirely on solar? The entire project, can we do it on solar? And probably you're the right person who can give an answer on that.
See, I think the bullet train need a power. It can be any power. The question is, can it be done on solar? Theoretically, yes. Practically, we need to see how we can do it. So the kind of power which this infrastructure will require, I believe it's, you know, few hundred kilometers of line. We need to see what is, how many megawatt or gigawatt of power which is required to run this line and how it can be supplied continuously. So when we talk on solar, the solar has its own curve, you know. So if you look at the curve, is like this. So this train may run in the night also. So we need to see whether we can use this train in the day only or in the night, and how it's going to work. So we may have to use some storage also. It may not be only solar. And we need to ensure it's a, you know, continuous power. So this bullet train is going to run on high speed. It cannot have, you know, any issue with the power supply. So the infrastructure also need to be built up. I believe we cannot do at this moment, but maybe in the future, this project may be feasible and possible.
if you look at the current Indian infrastructure, it will be a big challenge. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your opinion. I would like to pose one question to Kapil Maheshwari ji. So what would be your advice to government, SECI and MNRE to help quickly build up capacity in solar?
I think the question should have been asked to Mr. Narasimhan because he can correctly advise government on that. We as developers would definitely seek there's a lot of support from SECI and MNRE. I wouldn't say that it's not there. At this moment, I would say the only advice what a IPP like us would seek would be a certainty. So what is hampering a lot? See, you can bid for lower returns provided you know what will be your returns. So over a period of, see, all these solar projects, when you look at that, you're doing a discounted cash flow analysis to come out of return. So you would certainly look what returns it is giving me over a period of time. So if they can provide a little more certain framework, so it covers all of this. I mean, there's so much of uncertainty right now, just say on the safeguard duty itself. So if such a thing exists, it becomes difficult for an investor like us to see what tariff we should go to win a project, because you never know. There are uncertainty which exists because of the global framework, like, you know, the module prices where government doesn't create a lot of thing. I mean, if we are largely dependent on China, so are we. I mean, we're not changing it in a day or two, but where there could be a little more clarity to provide certainty is, you know, statements like there will be a pass through for the projects which are so, and there will not be any retrospective effect. So how do you ensure that retrospective effect will not come? Only people who have done reverse bidding would be included in that. Then what happens to large scale private PPAs and rooftop markets? How would they ensure that those projects had a PPA signed when there was no effect on safeguard duty? So such kind of certainty should come for it to take it forward. Otherwise, I think most of the things are in place and falling in place.
I must thank all the panelists for their expert opinion. Now we'll leave the floor open for Q&A. I think the organizers have given us up to 11:45. So we have 15 minutes for Q&A. Q&A is a very important factor in any discussion. This lady here, she's putting her hand first up. Please, I would request that should be specific questions and not opinions. And please tell us to whom you are addressing the question, whom do you want to answer the question. With this, and 30 seconds for the question and 1 minute for the answer. Let us go by that rule. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Sweta Sultania. I am from Ernst & Young. I have a question. I'll first put out the question and I would request whoever is best placed to take this up. There were several bids in Rajasthan where the bids happened before GST came into effect. And we understand that some of those developers have approached for a revision of the tariff on account of GST now getting imposed. So two questions on this. One is, what is your view, if you can share, in terms of whether there is a case for increase in tariff on account of GST, number one. And number two, more importantly, what kind of timelines one can look at for such resolution?
Pre-GST.
So an increase in tariff on account of GST for projects GST which came price, before GST was like in.
So bigger challenge there is, you know, whether it's SECI or any bidding authority, they never ever clarify that whether GST will be taken into account or not. While people have filed for it, even if, you know, it becomes a gray area, even if they do try, there'll be 10 other who will file a legal case that, you know, this was not part of the bid document, and probably there's a favor around that. And at the end of it, on all pre-bid meetings, at least they had said you can assume what you have to assume, because GST was always around the corner and was supposed to come. So I personally don't see really a case, but from an IPP perspective, obviously, I mean, that has happened to us also when we bid for SECI bids. I don't see that happening. I would like it to happen, but I don't see it.
The next question. You like?
Yeah, thank because you. We are getting, I think I slightly disagree with Rahul.
we believe it is going to be, you know, captured, and the PPA does have some provisions, and we are, you know, getting support from the government also. We believe they are going to support. It's not going to be investor friendly to capture, you know, the GST in the bids which has been already auctioned, you know. I believe the government is looking rationally and they will take care of this issue.
What kind of time?
Let me answer for GST. In spite of our several discussions with the Ministry of Renewable Energy, in one meeting in front of all the developers and as well as the manufacturers, it was assured by Government of India and MNRE Secretary and Minister themselves, they will try to avoid the GST imposition and try to bring the 0% GST for all the modules or kind of inverters to be imported. But officially the announcement has not come. We are trying to get the announcement to support for this project.
Please tell me, sir.
There is a notification which has been posted by MNRE. It is there on their website. Normally, it is 5% GST for any of the individual deliverables for modules, inverters, and all that balance of systems. Overall, also, because I am with GenSol for a small kind of a thing, I'll have a separate question later on. So, I think the clarity as of now is on a turnkey basis, if somebody were to execute a job, the overall percentage for EPC bidders should be 5% of the overall, whatever be the quoted rate kind of a thing. So, individually, you can take 5% overall, though 18% in some cases service charges, unless the labor and supply component are bifurcated, so that can be taken that way. 18% for labor and 5% for the supply component as a works contract.
Any other questions? Anybody else would like to ask a question?
Sir, today the subsidy of the MNRE and SECI for the private sector, that means for residential buildings, institutional and social sector, there was an order finalized by SECI, which is the implementation arm of MNRE, and they said that we want to, you know, kind of give a huge thrust to the what you call rooftop sector. Okay, everybody understands, and we know today we are 1.6 gigawatt as of January 2018. One can see the Mercom report, okay, and also Bridge to India. Now what we are saying is, when I'm representing GenSol, I asked him, because you are the lowest in four states, they have up to 25 kilowatt, a particular SECI awarded rate, similarly 25 kilowatt to 500 kilowatt. Unfortunately, when we approach them, they say, sir, mera SECI quota khatam ho gaya, mere paas abhi quota nahi hai. That means, who more so, I'm talking about CapEx projects. Now, there are two categories. One is CapEx. That means what? Rooftop owner is the one who will be owning the installation. I, as a project developer or as a EPC contractor, will install. What is my objective? My objective is to install and let him enjoy. Suppose he is getting at a rate of about 4 rupees.
Tell us your question.
Now, my question is, there is no SECI quota. So on the one hand, if you maintain, there is SECI, 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 there is no SECI. And that means one has to take strongly, without a SECI quota subsidy, nobody will be able to do any rooftop, be it a very rich person or a small person. So SECI quota means some, you know, support from the government has to come. Similarly, on the RESCO model, if I say PPA rate, what is your credit rating? What is your CRISIL rating? What is your net worth? So this is all going to be big things and nothing is going to happen. That is my humble submission.
My dear friend, whatever your grievances, definitely we'll take up to SECI. You say that you don't want SECI, but everybody wants a SECI. We'll see that SECI is functioning properly well, because there was no proper head in past few months. Now Joint Secretary has become the MD of SECI. All your kind of grievances, we'll take the clarification. If there is any wrong from SECI, we'll see that it is supported for you.
Thank you.
And naturally.
Thank you, the panelists, and thank you all the delegates. One more, Ananji, the one question is there. Can we give? Yeah, please.
Somebody just now mentioned that each state has got different rules, or each state discoms, and there will be a regularization in terms of what you call rules and all. But along with these discoms, those who are not allowing net metering or putting hurdles, there is one more entity like corporations which say, I got a open terrace and I want to put a this thing, solar plant for myself, my house and this thing. They do not give permission to erect a shed. If I erect a shed for solar without telling them, they'll come and bring down that shed. Those corporations have got different rules, and they say, we do not bother. Government of India has said solar karo up,
हम लोग अलाउ नहीं करेंगे. दीज आर थिंग्स, स्मॉल स्मॉल थिंग्स विच आर डिटरेंट टू इंडिविजुअल रेजिडेंशियल हाउसेस एंड स्मॉल ईपीसी प्लेयर्स आर फेसिंग प्रॉब्लम्स हियर.
सचिन जी, वुड यू लाइक टू रिप्लाई?
I am not exactly aware of your face, but generally for any kind of building structures, you will have to take proper approvals, whether it is different local bodies, because those structures should be, you know, like for example, the solar structure, the weight of that, the building should be able to take that. Plus, there are many innovative structures where the structures may be going outside the building dimensions. So such things needs to be taken care, and if it is everything is done properly, there shouldn't be any such problem. There may be some particular cases which might have faced this, but at a very larger level, if you take a proper approvals, then it should be okay, I believe.
I'll just add to that. I mean, yes, your question is, if your question is that various states have different policies, yes. And does that harm us in implementation of all that policies? The answer to that also is yes. Because a developer, if he wants to implement project in various states, you need to see all of those policies where the regulators can be. So you typically would take, if it's a captive consumption project, you typically would take a CIG or the state DISCOM approval, even if it's a captive consumption project. But you also need to see what size of project you want to implement, whether you are consuming 100% or do you want to take an approval for net metering. Most states right now have on paper a net metering policy which exists, but I would say only 20% of those states actually have an net metering policy which is easy to implement. So
I fully agree with you, because there are say Mumbai corporation, they have got different rules. They are not telling openly any clearly. Just go a little outside, there is Navi Mumbai corporation has different rules. If you go to any other place like Kolhapur or Satara or whatever, they have a totally different set of rules, and they do not disclose any rules. Last minute they will put some hurdles. These are the basic hurdles people are facing, and government is just announcing so many gigawatts and this thing. This is a big talk, but at a lower level, there are many people, many DISCOMs and many corporations putting hurdles, and this dream is really going to drain now.
Sir, we'll address.
Actually, I understood what is the problem.
One minute, sir. Sir, we will. Would it be okay if we address this during tea break? Because you can have. You can talk one to one.
This kind of representation can be undertaken to the Chief Minister. We know very well Maharashtra directly or indirectly is not supporting much of the solar project. It's a corporation or outside suburban corporation. You please specify these grievances. I will take up to the level of the Chief Minister. These kind of grievances, confusions can be sorted out.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I would just sum up the morning's discussion. We thank the panelists, Maheshwari ji, Jain saab, Jindal ji, Naksuman sir, Mishra ji, for their valuable inputs. There has been one common remark by all the panelists regarding the insurance of the solar generation. Probably what little I know about the subject is that the insurance can be taken for the PR, not anything beyond that, a percentage of the PR. Beyond that, no insurance company will give you on the generation, on the actual generation of the plant, as what stands today in India and abroad also. That is one point I wanted to make. Second, I would say the duty structure that has also been raised by everybody, 5% and 18%. Probably the government will definitely come out with a clarification soon. It should happen any time. The government is fully aware of this, that there is an anomaly, and it will be put in order very soon. Regarding foreign funding, I think the financing section would be able to handle on that. But I can tell you, with my little experience in the line, that if money is to come from abroad, it has to be in big tranches. It has to be in $100 million plus. Foreign investors are not interested in small transactions. And when you try to hedge the cost, if you're especially bringing a currency other than dollar, if it's going to be, a Japanese yen, then double hedging is required. You can't hedge between the Japanese yen and the dollar and US dollar to India. that becomes a very complicated process. So if you are an exporter, you have a natural hedge and you want to put up the plant in the name of your company, yes, it is possible. If you don't, otherwise the PPAs are not, none of the PPAs are dollar denominated. Formerly, we used to have these where we have a part of the PPA in dollar and part in rupee. Those PPAs are not prevalent today. They say way back, these PPAs were quite prevalent when Enron was there. But now these PPAs are not popular with the government. Regarding the rooftops, there has been a lot of concern. I think what is to be focused on is, what I feel is, you should not think of 100 kilowatt and 200 kilowatt project. Think of small projects, 5 kilowatt, 10 kilowatt, and multiply them across the country. I think even a city like Delhi, a lot of such projects are possible. And with these few remarks, I hand over the mic to the organizers. I thank the organizers for the wonderful arrangement that they are making. And I thank all the panelists also for their valuable contribution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I think very, very important points came out. I would really like to thank all the panelists, all the audience, all delegates for spending a very, very valuable time with us this morning. Indeed, I value time above everything else. So indeed, it's a great contribution and help towards what EQ has been trying to do, trying to spread more awareness, spread more dialogue, and connect more solar businesses. So thank you very much. As a word, I would like to request Narasimhanji to present small mementos to all the speakers on the dais, please.
Thank you.